I'm gonna tell you this right now. If you woke up this morning, nigga, you winning. For real. Yeah.
I got a big amount, I took a different round. I am the pick of the little. I was a juvie, it gave me community. I had to pick up some little. I want it easy, please do not tease me. I want my Yeezy to dinner. This is the season, I got the season. Don't make me sprinkle you.
What is going on, everyone? Psych Perspectives, giofvcks. And we are about to kick off Black Skin, White Mask by France Fanon. Sociology and race relations. It's also a mix of psychology in this, because again, he was trained as a psychiatrist. And there's a lot of psychoanalysis being made here. And he's constantly referencing both of the Freud, Sigmund and Anna Freud. I think that is so cool. Again, you're also talking about a book that's over a half a century old, okay? This came out in 1952. Think about that. My grandmother was 7 years old when this came out. So just to put that into perspectives, all right? So we do understand when we're reading this, do understand the time frame, okay? We're talking about the early 50s, 1952. Think about 1950s, think about this is 3 years before Emmett Till in the USA was murdered and killed in Mississippi. So, and we're also notice the differences, how, you know, yes, as you read the book, you'll notice he will make references to some of the American USA, like pop culture, music, films, society, and what have you. But he's specifically talking about what's going on in Europe, France, and the French Antilles. I think that is very deep, so people can kind of see how white supremacy and racism is a global phenomenon. It's a global world issue. It's not just in the USA or just in Europe or just, it's a global issue. And you can see the parallels and the similarities and the differences, but at the end of the day, you can still see the injustices, right? In this book, okay, so think about the time, again, 1950s, early 1950s at that, 1952, the time and the location. And then also keep in mind what's happening and what's going on right now, currently. Have things really changed or progressed? Are things kind of just the same? You let me know. So we're gonna start off with the first chapter. And the first chapter is the Black Man and Language. Now, as discussed, each week we will cover a chapter out of this book. And the video discussion, like what I'm doing right now for chapter one, will be posted Thursdays at 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. The live streams will be Sundays, 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on YouTube. Chapter one, I'll read a little bit and then discuss some things. That's basically how the video discussions will be. I'll read a little bit, pull out some inserts, I'll tell you what page it is, and I'll read it and what have you. And we'll talk about some different perspectives and things that I pulled from it. Because again, this is my second time reading this. Anyways, let's get back into it. So chapter one, The Black Man and Language. We attach a fundamental importance to the phenomenon of language. Consequently, consider the study of language essential for providing us with one element in understanding the black man's dimension of being for others. It being understood that to speak is to exist absolutely for the other. The black man, and notice, and I just have to bring this up, because back then, this is how, you know, we talk about racism and white supremacy and, you know, this inferiority complex, because that's essentially why I picked this book. Us being less than, and then the superiority of white folks. And then he brings up narcissism numerous times in this. Again, I have a method to my madness. I loved this when I was reading it in undergrad, but I was reading it for research purposes and not leisurely. This time I'm getting to read it leisurely, so I'm getting more out of it. In the book, you'll notice that he will write black, lowercase b. This is how subconscious this shit is, the inferiority complex, right? Like us being less than. For a very long period of time, you know, they would say the black man, the black woman, or what have you, but the B would always be lowercase. Meanwhile, when we say white, the white man, the white woman, the white person, it's always a capital W. But for years, the B would be, again, subconsciously, you might think this is just small and minute and, oh, you're reading too much into it. Nah, this shit is mental. This shit is mental. This is psychological slavery, psychological mental abuse and oppression. Shit's deep. The black man possesses two dimensions. One with his fellow blacks, which he does. The other with the whites. A black man behaves differently with a white man than he does another black man. Which, again, language. Comfortability. We talk about this a lot. When you around people that you're comfortable with, and y'all have a understanding, a mutual agreement, there's similarities, and that's basically your in group, you do have a different type of behavior, mood, language, culture. And this is very true. I know I can talk to other black people like this, but I know I couldn't necessarily go into a white community or a community of mixed social constructions of races, ethnicities, heritage, cultures, and even in black communities, depending on your class type. You know, are you working class? Are you middle class? Are you upper class? You know, depending on a lot of different factors, even within the same race, there's differences, ethnicities and heritage. We black, but I'm black American, Midwest, and my other friend is from Nigeria, upper class. Totally, we might be black, but we have differences, okay? So anyways, he's talking about that to say, again, we have to play these dual dynamics. And I already know the next book we're reading, because if we're gonna read this, we gotta read W.E.B. Du Bois, The Souls of Black Folks. And, cause we gotta kinda piggyback. See me, if I'm gonna do these book reviews and book clubs and discussions, and then also live streams, I really want us to have a good time, and I want it to be fun and interactive, okay? There is no doubt whatsoever that this is Fiziporoneness is a direct consequence of the colonial undertaking. Nobody dreams of challenging the fact that its principles' inspiration is nurtured by the core of theories which represent the black man as the missing link in the slow evolution from ape to man. These are objective facts that state reality. Now again, remember, for so long they always had black people. We were, in the USA, for example, we were viewed as 3/5 human. They never viewed black people as human beings. We were viewed as 3/5. And there was always this, well, they're from the apes. They're from the apes. They're from the monkeys. And then the thing is, we're all evolutionized from primates, including white people. So the ignorance, the racism, you know, and then to continue to view us as animals and not human beings, and then you wonder why today in 2021, new millennium, going into the future, the frontier and all this shit, and we're still sitting up here with police killing us, the hospitals killing us, oh, you don't feel pain, oh, well, they're vicious, they're violent, these views of us being brutes, vicious and violent and animals, and just this is all rooted out of racism and white supremacy. But once we have taken note of the situation, once we have understood it, we consider the job done. How can we possibly not hear the voice again tumbling down the steps of history? It's no longer a question of knowing the world, but of transforming it. This question is terribly present in our lives. To speak means being able to use a certain syntax and possessing the morphology of such and such a language. But it means above all, assuming a culture and bearing the weight of a civilization. Since the situation is not one-sided, the study should reflect this. We would very much like to be given credit for certain points that, however unacceptable they may appear early on, will prove to be factual accurate. The problem we shall tackle in this chapter And if you notice, in each, what I like about this, what people don't understand is, yes, this is a book, but this is very much a thesis, a dissertation. And if you notice, as you read the book, you'll notice footnotes at the bottom. I believe this is either Chicago or just Chicago style or Tiberian. What I'm saying is this is a certain style of citing your work, aka having facts to back up your claims and where you're basing your theories and perspectives on. Okay, fact checking. So you'll notice there's footnotes at the bottom and there'll be a number. And the number will appear, you know, as you're reading. And that's basically telling you, if you go to chapter one of Chame Lapathy, I'm pronouncing this horribly. I don't speak French. Maybe I can learn that. I have time now. Language and aggressiveness, and you will find out, oh, okay, if I go to that chapter, I can find that in that book to follow up where Fanon is getting his information from. Cite your work. Yes, this is a book, but it's very much, it is a academic research analysis. It's a psychoanalysis. And he's a psychiatrist. He's a doctor. I just want to bring that up. And then he will go in and kind of let you know how each chapter, what he's going to talk about in that chapter. So that's how he introduces it. I wanted to talk about this chapter in particular because we're always talking about, you know, what's proper. Proper English, proper French, you know, you gotta speak the king's English. Anything that's not seen as white is not seen as proper. Again, you think the shit's sublime, deep, oh, you guys are woke, oh, that, it ain't that serious, and it's not that. If it's not that serious, then why must white always be the standard? You know, even when you go to get picture frames, it's mostly white families in the picture frames. When you watch TV, it's still mostly white people on TV. You know, and again, you say it's not that big of a deal, but, oh, it's not that serious. But if it's not that serious, then why would it be a problem with adding other people that aren't white, other people of color? So when we get to language and we start looking at, oh, well, don't talk ghetto. What is ghetto? Oh, well, that's ratchet. What is ratchet? Oh, Ebonics. Speak correct. Pronounce your E's and R's and your D's and W's and all this other stuff. And you start realizing a lot of this is bred out of anti-blackness, white supremacy, and racism. Because a lot of people who are not white, we have all, whether you're black, whether you're Hispanic, you're Latino, you're Asian, you're Pacific Islander, you're Native American, indigenous, if you're a person of color, more than likely, you have been told that you need to speak a certain way, talk a certain way, pronounce words, pronunciate. And a lot of this is because what? That's ghetto. And notice anything that's related to your language or how you naturally would speak with your people, anything indigenous, organic, that's really from you and your culture, anything related to that is seen as what? Stupid, ignorant, less than. That teaches people subconsciously that our native way of doing things, our natural way of doing things, what we've been doing and how we talk and our language, and you're telling us that we are less than, stupid, and that's not good. And this is deep because in this chapter, there is a discussion about people speaking Creole and then speaking French. I always think about, I have friends that live in Haiti, who are from Haiti. Then I also have family in Louisiana. How this language I always heard, just like Patois, is it Patois in Jamaica? And again, notice Creole, Patois, you know, Ebonics here in America. In the USA, it's always seen as being less than or not being educated yet. And then they really set up here and told us, have a language, and that is our language. And it's clearly a language, because we can say something like he said, I'm not going to talk to you. The black man has a different language for other blacks that he doesn't use when he's engaging with the white man. And also notice, again, this is in the 50s. So when they're saying man, they're talking about humans. It's like when they say mankind, they're talking about humankind. Really, we should just say humankind. Let's just be honest. Because when you say man, again, subconsciously, I don't care how you try to twist and turn it, you're literally erasing women. And you're erasing people from it. You're just basically saying man, okay? Just like when you sit up and we make the standard, we've made man, men, cis men in particular. And when you start reading this book, cis white men in particular, the standard for everything. Which means everybody else is what? Behind the white man. And we end up having this white supremacy power structure that's holding the oppression, but then dangling down is all the other oppressions. Said, you got the racism, you got white supremacy that bursts to racism, to sexism, to homophobia, to classism, but it's all birthed from keeping that white supremacist power structure up here. That's one of the perspectives that I got again out of this. And again, throughout this book and this chapter, I'm gonna read this for example. I'm from Martinique. This is my very first visit to France. He knows that what the poets call divine cooing, meaning Creole, is but a term midway between Creole and French. In the French Antilles, the bourgeoisie does not use Creole. Now here, when we talk about bourgeoisie, we're talking about middle class. Now this is where, again, you got white supremacy, you got racism, and you also have classism. Because then you do have the bourgeoisie. So you can have blacks, they're black, but they're middle class, and the middle class blacks will shit on and hate on lower class, working class, working poor blacks. And again, you continue to have this division, even though you're both black. And right now in the USA, we have this division within black communities, but then we have this division across the country with everybody. Everybody's fighting and killing each other. And in the meantime, the rich and the wealthy are getting what? Wealthier, richer, and more powerful. And if you look, it doesn't matter what color. Oh, hold up. Now, when I say it doesn't matter what color, don't get me wrong. Cliff note disclaimer. It matters, because it's still mostly white people who are wealthy and rich and controlling the show. But if you look around, there's also black rich folks, you know, your Jay-Z's, your P. Diddy's, your Oprah Winfrey's, and that's just the black people in the USA. There's black people globally making money who are millionaires and billionaires. You have Asians, also millionaires and billionaires. Hispanic, Latino, also millionaires, billionaires. And if you all notice, regardless, they're all making more money, and everyone else is doing what? Suffering, losing out, being deprived, going without, dying. We can't see that, right? Because we can't see the forest for the trees. So while we're all sitting up arguing, fussing, fighting, killing each other, white supremacy is controlling all of this, and then you have the racism and the classism and all this is happening, but the common denominator is, listen, we're all gonna live, some of us, and all of us, regardless, are gonna die. And we need certain things to live. We all do. We can't see the forest for the trees. Okay, in the French Antilles, the bourgeoisie does not use Creole except when speaking to servants. Who are their servants? Again, you have other wealthy blacks, and this is across what's going on here in France, and it was also happened here. You had wealthy blacks that also did the same thing. They'll talk to you, yeah, what up, man, what up, man, yeah. Then, what's going on, Tom? What's going on, Jack? How are you? Haha, living the dream. And then you see all these split personalities, because they're literally black skin, white mask. The thin unveiling of the veil, which is what W.E.B. Du Bois discusses in Souls of Black Folk. There's some other books we'll read on, but again, that's coming into the future. I just think that's deep. I think that is something to think about, because we're always code switching. There you go. And when you really look at code switching, you're having multiple different personalities, because you're not able, you're not free, you're not seen, you're not honored, you're not respected, you're not allowed to be your authentic self. So you have to play all these different positions. Like I said, they can use Creo with the servants, okay, because we're looking down on you, but at the same time, I am you. But because I got some money, I feel like I'm better and I'm a talented person. You see the self-hate, and they literally are teaching us all to hate each other and to not help each other. And there's power in numbers. So if everyone is hating each other and not helping each other, we're never going to progress. That's why I asked at the beginning of this video, you know, when this book came out in 1952, 2021, my grandmother was 7 when this came out. She's 76 right now. So my question is, what progression? We're still doing the same shit. It's just, it's different. You know, they give us the illusion that we have somehow arrived and we have somehow, we're doing better, when no, police still killing black folks. People still racist. Sexism is still alive. Women still being murdered and killed for saying goodbye or not wanting to, you know, do something with another person. It's crazy. It's the same shit that was happening 70 years ago is happening now. I'm just saying. At the school, the young Martinician is taught to treat the dialect with contempt. So this is deep, right? Because I always think about the traditional schools that, once again, the USA government put up along with those Catholic schools, that they would put indigenous Native Americans, they would literally snatch their children from them. Just like how they did our people. They snatched our children from our family members all through slavery. Ripping and destroying families. Trauma and generation after generation. And if you notice, it's happening too right now when you look at those ICE concentration camps. When you look at what's happening there, they're ripping and snatching families from people. From their parents. Parents from their kids. Not providing them with adequate food and health care and services while they have them forever detained. Children have gone missing. Children have been sexually assaulted and abused. All kinds of things have happened. And you think about slavery, again, raped, snatched, killed, abused. You think about the Native Americans and indigenous people, and I'm just talking about in the USA. Now you're seeing the comparison to what's going on in this book in 1952 in France. Same situation. So they go to these schools, like the traditional schools here in America. Beat out of you your culture. You're not supposed to speak your language. You're not supposed to care about your religion or spiritual beliefs. Nothing related to who you truly are is seen as being important. Instead, it's savage, it's barbaric, it's stupid, it's dumb, it's disgusting, it's filth, it's inferior. And everything that's superior and good and positive and righteous and the best is white, European. That's what's seen as being educated and intelligent. And every time you turn around, oh, it's not that serious, you're looking too deep into it. If that's the case, then why is it a problem when we want to talk about African American history, Native American history, Hispanic, Latino Heritage Month, Asian Heritage Month? Why is it a problem? Right, because again, y'all have the issue with, you think you're superior, narcissism. You think your culture is the only important thing, ethnocentric. Which is where the white supremacy comes from. I mean, this is like a global phenomenon. And then, like I said, everybody else, we're all seen as not being good enough, while at the same time, you're constantly stealing other people's culture and then saying that you created it. It's why, and to this day, you can look back at books and pictures, and you will see pictures